I'm a prisoner of 2,000 years of the Catholic Church. All Italians are.
I want to help you understand why this is so. I want you to imagine you are a little boy or girl, 500 years ago, and you are about to enter this chapel. This is the Cappella Nuova, and it was here that an artist called Signorelli was given a very difficult task, to paint in detail the unpaintable, the end of the world. Signorelli follows the events as described in the Book of Revelations. The world is seduced by the preaching of the Antichrist. Brutal henchmen strangle good friars. They scour the streets for dissenters and drag them away for execution. Then, Apocalisse.
The world is over. For a while there is silence and nothing. And then a trumpet sounds from heaven. Angels summon mankind for the last judgment.
Naked and bemused, humanity rises to new life. They look around them, trying to adjust to this strange place.
But it does not last. They are divided into two. The good are sent to heaven, but the rest are sent to hell. What a mess, an orgy of suffering. So imagine what you, a little boy or girl, 500 years ago, would feel. You would have been terrified. This is what happens if you sin. And whether you grow up a believer or not, the memory of this, the terror, will always be with you.
No, you don't come. Means don't forget you are my darling.
Buongiorno, sono le 7:30 di mattina qui a Radio Mano. È ora di svegliarsi e uscire fuori all'aria aperta, perché oggi sarà una giornata bellissima.
I'm entering Tuscany, a little corner of Italy that is forever England. You even call it Chianti Shire.
Thank you.
You British have a dream. And the dream is, you will become rich and move here. You will buy a little villa, become an expert in wine, eat wonderful food. And then, if lucky, find yourself a Latin lover, like me.
The first to live the dream was an English woman called Iris Cutting. She married Count Antonio Origo in 1921, and together they bought the vast estate of La Foce in Val d'Orcia. When they first came here, the land was barren. But they turned 8,000 acres into fertile farmland with a beautiful garden at its heart. Come to meet their daughter, Benedetta.
Eccoli, benvenuta alla
Grazie
Foce,
infinito
Francesca.
Dell'accoglienza, è un piacere, veramente. Bene, qui ho un piccolo pensiero da Venezia, sono dei baiccoli, biscotti veneziani.
Buonissimi, buonissimi.
Tanto così, sono un po' rovinati, ma siamo da un lungo viaggio.
Grazie,
arrivano.
Grazie.
Grazie,
andiamo a prendere un caffè.
Volentieri.
Proprio l'amore per questa terra che ha portato qui i miei genitori, che erano appena sposati, molto innamorati, e sono arrivati in Val d'Orcia e hanno visto davanti a loro questo paesaggio lunare fatto di crete, di grande povertà dei contadini, e se ne innamorarono immediatamente. Cominciarono a mettere tutto a posto, c'era tutto da fare. Non c'era luce, non c'era acqua, la casa era in pessime condizioni, dovevano veramente cominciare da zero. Veramente, start from scratch, as my mother used to say.
Questo è un po' un giardino italiano o inglese?
Difficile dirlo. È un giardino in Italia, creato all'italiana da un inglese. Ma insomma segue in fondo l'idea, il principio rinascimentale, umanistico, del giardino che fa parte della casa e che poi via via che si allontana ci sono i terrazzi, più fiori, alberi e poi il bosco.
La degradazione verso il ritorno alla natura.
Certo. Questa era l'idea del giardino loro e che hanno sviluppato lungo il corso di 15 anni. C'è una lettera di mia madre a un amico che dice: I'm looking out of my window and I see a mud hole in front of the house which will one day, one hopes, become a fountain.
Questa è un po' l'immagine che abbiamo noi tutti della Toscana.
La Val d'Orcia in fondo è uno dei pochissimi luoghi della Toscana e dell'Italia che è rimasta veramente intatta. Ecco, si vede qui, non c'è un oggetto, una casa, una fabbrica che possa offendere l'occhio.
Tuscany wasn't always a paradise. In the Middle Ages, it was a battleground where rival towns struggled for land and wealth. Towns were fortresses first and foremost, built on hilltops for defense, with mighty walls and towers.
but the people of San Gimignano were not defending themselves from neighboring towns, but from each other.
The great families of San Gimignano had become rich through trade. They were tough business rivals, and sometimes they fought in the streets of the town.
These great towers weren't lived in. They were symbols of wealth and power. San Gimignano's families competed to have the tallest tower. Eventually, to discourage this rivalry, it was decreed that no tower could exceed 51 meters.
Not even this was enough to stop the Salvucci family. They built their tower to the full height, and then they built an identical tower next to it. These are the twin towers of San Gimignano. A town of towers is a sad thing. Is a town at war with itself. No sense of civic pride. Everything is for the individual. Towers are at once beautiful and terrifying.
The neighboring town of Siena tells a different story. In the 13th century, this was the perfect city, a place designed to inspire civic pride and prosperity.
When you walk in Siena, you always feel that you're being led towards larger streets. And these larger streets lead into even larger streets. And then these main streets bring you down and down toward the center. Then finally, wherever you started, you arrive in this. The great campo of Siena. Bellissimo. It is truly amazing here. Before, the center of Siena, as in most towns, was around the cathedral. So by building a new center around the town hall, the council was saying that the most sacred thing in Siena was not God, but the city itself.
Walking the streets of Siena, a sense of citizenship is never far away. I am constantly reminded that I'm just one small part of a greater whole.